Fall is here, and you know what that means? Berkeley is filled with performances, festivals, and events throughout the semester.
From the Music Business Opportunities Expo next month, to the Lady Gaga Ensemble show at the BPC, there's so much to look forward to. And guess what? A lot of these incredible experiences are made possible by our generous donors.
Want to keep these events going strong? You can make a difference at berkeley.edu/giving. Your support helps create unforgettable moments for us students.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the first episode of season 2 of Pass the Mic, where we pass the mic to you. We are super excited. We've missed you. And of course, you know, we have Patrick. Hey, Patrick.
And now we can say welcome to the award-winning podcast,
whoop, Pass the whoop. Mic. Jonah, play some music here.
Yeah, Jonah.
Some claps.
Some claps and some music. Come on. So yeah, where do we want to start? Because there were multiple awards.
Multiple awards.
The first one is that we received a bronze award for best podcast in the Circle of Excellence with Case.
Yes. Heavy on the
Jonah
Circle
Moore
of
claps.
Excellence. Yes.
Yes. do you know what Case stands for, Jaquel?
No.
Off the top of your head?
What does it stand for?
It's the Council for Advancement and Support of Education. This is a higher ed award. And we are in very good company with our bronze award for season 1 of Pass the Mic podcast. We are in the same sphere as Brown University, the Ohio State University, the University of Miami, Stanford University, and Purdue University. I think that alumni can be proud that they're up with those elites.
It's really cool to just be able to know that our work is being recognized even after just one season.
So that's the first award. But also, we were up for 2 Brassy Awards. Do you know what Brassy stands for off the top of your head, Jaquel?
I don't. What does it mean?
So every year, there's a Brass Day on campus. And it stands for Berkeley Recognition and Acknowledgement of Spectacular Staff.
Spectacular.
Spectacular. So Jaquel got a nomination for Performance Excellence Award. And Jaquel and I were co-nominated for the Collaboration Award for our digital engagement team. And Jaquel, I have a couple of clips that reveal how those went.
The exact moment. Of course you do.
The awards go to...
Jaquel, woo! Yeah! Yeah! Jaquel, you just won!
Yeah! Yeah! Oh my gosh. That is right. So funny.
Just so people can have in their mind's eye, this was in the Berkeley Performance Center, and it was a packed house of all the Berkeley staff. The awards are pretty cool, too. They're like legit like trophies, like...
Yes,
stars, and it says Brassy.
Huge. Yeah, you name know. On it and everything. Real professional. Shout out to Berkeley.
Yeah, as always, wait, great though, on the branding. Yeah.
I want to talk about everything that leading up to this. So for some reason, Patrick already knew that I won, right? And so some things were coming up and everything he just kept saying was, you're coming to the awards, right? You're going to come though, right? I'm like, oh, I just got a ticket. You're going to come though, right? Like, it's just, he just had no care for what was going on. I'm like, dang, why is this event so important to this man? But come to find out, I won. And, you know, I definitely was not expecting it. So, like, just hearing my name being called, the team being there and cheering me on, like, it really meant a lot. I'm just super thankful and appreciative, you know, that I'm being recognized. And it definitely means so, so much to me.
So, I have a clip of our collaboration award and how that went. Okay, we're waiting. The drum roll. Ah, come on! Come on, man.
No.
Ugh, terrible.
It's the music coming up in the background.
I know, like, right?
Ugh. It's like a happy song, and then you're just like, yeah, get out of here.
That was the house band that was all Berkeley staff.
Yes.
Which was, they were really good. I'm happy for you, but that still hurt. It hurts to listen back on that and think of what
might
have been.
It's okay, we're going to get them.
And also, today we are recording episode 1, season 2. I am in Chicago, and Jaquel, you are
in Austin. Shout out to all the alums in these areas.
One of our digital engagement campaigns that we planned out for the beginning of this year was to go to some emerging regions. And so we are having an event tonight in Chicago, Austin, and Cleveland all at the same time. To shout out those other regions that have a big industry presence, but maybe not as populated as New York or Los Angeles. So we're trying to go to these areas and build up some volunteer teams, show the different kinds of events that we can have and that we can help support. So if you are in one of those regions where you know you have a good contingent of Berkeley alumni, you know, it doesn't have to be an event that has 80,000 people, you know, we don't have to fill a football stadium, but small little groups that want to get together and maybe do a writer's round or plan a holiday party or something like that, feel free to reach out to us at alumniaffairs@berkeley.edu, and we can definitely have a conversation with all of you. And if you are in Austin, Cleveland, Chicago areas, feel free to reach out to us. We're starting to develop these teams of on-the-ground volunteers, and we'd love to have you be a part of it.
Speaking of engaged and tuned in, it is time to tune in into the episode we have for you today. What is this episode, boss? Who are we interviewing?
We are interviewing Mark Kelley, Alumni Achievement Award recipient and bass player for the legendary Roots Crew.
Legendary.
Yeah, it's an awesome interview. And Colleen is in the interview as well. Colleen was Mark's RA in the dorms when he started. And Colleen actually has a pretty interesting portfolio of alumni that she was an RA for. She was an RA for John Mayer. She was an RA for Clay Cook of the Zac Brown Band, Bob Reynolds from Snarky Puppy. She also was an RA for Kevin Williams of Regiment Horns, and Leon Silva, who has played with the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones and Ariana Grande. And like that, she was the RA for Mark Kelley of the legendary Roots Crew, the house band for The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon.
Yes, everybody, this is the interview with me, Mark Kelley, Patrick, and Colleen. Enjoy. Hi, Mark. Welcome back.
Hey, how are you doing? I'm good. How are you?
I'm well. Congrats on being the recipient of the Alumni Achievement Award.
Thank you.
How does it feel to be back in Boston?
Great. I've been here a few times, but every time I come here, it's with the Roots, and it's usually during the Christmas holiday season, so school is closed. Mm. Everything's a little different in the city. So it's usually, I'm here for like a night and then on to somewhere else. So this is the first time that I've been back to really just kind of hang out and be around.
That's awesome. So you were born in Houston.
Oh.
How did Berkeley come across your radar? Like, what was your Berkeley story to come here?
I went to a performing arts high school in Houston.
HSPVA.
HSPVA. And they, we had a bunch of different schools that they were kind of pushing for us to go to, the new school in New York, Manhattan School of Music, and Berkeley was another one. And Berkeley was doing a scholarship tour, doing the auditions. I think ours was in Austin. So I went and just did the audition, and I got a scholarship, not a full scholarship, but I got a scholarship, a decent amount of money. And two other guys that were seniors, one who teaches here, Walter Smith, and another guy, Kendrick Scott.
Both who are phenomenal musicians in and of their own right.
Wow. Excellent musicians. They got scholarships as well. And so we all just ended up coming to Berkeley. I didn't even entertain.
No plan Bs.
No. It was just Berkeley's the one. They gave me a scholarship. And so I just said, okay, and that's the one. So I just came here.
Were you nervous about coming all the way over here in the north?
No. Not really, because most of everybody, my parents did that when they went to college. They went away far. It was just kind of always been understood in my mind that I was going to go somewhere far away from home for college.
Cool. So Houston is like a really popular area for musicians. Uh-huh. You know, we got Beyonce, we got Megan Thee Stallion, you know. So I wanted to know, do you have like a top three musicians from your area?
From Houston?
Yeah.
Musicians?
Yeah.
From my area. I mean, well, I'll say Beyonce is definitely a favorite just because, I mean, she went to the same high school as me. We went there.
Oh, she did?
She did. My sophomore year was her freshman year. And then
This school, I'm telling you.
She stayed
like
a second year.
What?
And then I remember they left school and everybody was joking, like, they're gonna they're going to they're getting a record deal. They're going. Somebody said they were getting a record deal, and that was like the word. And everybody's like, "They're stupid. They're gonna they're leaving school. They're gonna all this." And then
yeah, all
thing
the smart
know,
music industry people.
They have their what was their hit single? Like Destiny's Child's first single, the one they did with Wyclef and Dwayne from Tony. The one that's like I can't remember the title, but they their hit single dropped, and they just kind of blew up from there.
So you was actually in the same school when she was there.
I was.
Do you remember her?
I do.
Wow.
I feel like we need to do a whole other podcast episode about this.
Yeah, like how
tell
cool
us about
is
Beyonce.
That? Yeah. That's amazing. Yeah. Like it was that school was really full with greats.
By the way, the song I think was No No No.
That's it.
No,
there we
no,
go.
No, no, yep. No.
Did you just Google that?
I did.
That's, okay, just making sure.
That was the first song, and that's when I knew. I was like, wow, they made it. And then they just kept going from there.
Wow. Yeah.
This is amazing. A huge aside, but that's my role here, is one of my friends from film school lived in Quincy, Illinois, and Destiny's Child was playing at a festival there.
Mm-hmm.
And the opening act backed out or something, so they auditioned like all the bands in Quincy, Illinois, and his band won, and so he opened for Destiny's Child.
Nice.
And whenever like something's going wrong in his life, he just screams, "I opened for Destiny's Child."
That is a bragging right though.
Yeah, absolutely. I would say so.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. So before you stuck to the bass, you started playing the cello and the guitar. Can you explain what made you want to stick to the bass? Like, what about it?
Well, I wanted to play guitar, and I wasn't so great at it. And my uncle was a bassist, and he would talk to me about playing, and I was still kind of on the fence. I didn't really care much about it. And then my father is a classical pianist, but also plays the pipe organ at church. So he got a job at a Baptist church, and we went to go check it out. And the bass player they had there was incredible. Like I had never seen a church service that was as good as theirs. I saw that, and I knew the second I saw that, I was like, I'm going to play. The guy's name was Keith Bivens. He was an incredible bass player from Houston. I guess that would be another one of my favorite
there you go.
Houston
you
musicians.
You gave me two people, though. One That's person, one, two.
Beyonce, Keith Bivens. Everybody from Houston's going to be like, wow. Beyonce, Keith Bivens. And so I got a singer, a drummer.
Rounded out.
Another great Houston musician. Wow.
You better say Walter or Kendrick or they're going to be mad at you.
I mean, come on. They know that they're my favorites. They know. They already know that. But aside from my obvious favorite, I'd say Chris Dave. Chris Dave is an excellent drummer from Houston and is much older than all of us and kind of was one, you know, I remember seeing Chris a long time ago. My sister went to high school with him. And I remember during the Christmas holiday, they were playing at this jazz club in Houston. And I had a rock band. And I remember the kids who played in my band. I remember thinking, like, I've never seen people play play instruments the way these kids do. And I thought they were really good. And I went and saw Chris play. My mind was blown. Like, I've never seen it. I didn't even know people could play drums like that. You know, that was my first introduction to watching, like, a jazz drummer and somebody playing. Like, I'd never heard music like that or seen somebody play. And so that to me was like an eye opener for where music can go, you know, as a kid seeing that. So those are my three.
So while you was at Berkeley, you was able to perfect your craft with the bass and you was able to develop a technique to manipulate time. Can you explain what that means?
Yeah, sure. So manipulating time, I think in the simplest form is just what grooves are, you know, and everybody has their ways of doing it, which kind of make us interpret groove or feel groove differently, you know. And for me, during that time, D'Angelo's Voodoo album was new. It was a brand new album at that time. And that's all everybody was listening to. And Pino Palladino was the bass player on that album. And Questlove, my boss, was the drummer on that record. And the way that they played, everything was like so laid back. Like it was almost as if like the snare was sometimes the snare was rushed and the hi-hats and the bass were laid back, and it kind of created this unique kind of push and pull between the bass and the drums where you'd hear these things. And even on like ballads, like how Pino would play so far behind the beat, it was just incredible. But it was like, it wasn't like it was like out of place. It was just creating this groove that was undeniable. And so that became my focus. Like I was so taken by that concept that every song that I played, like that was my approach with everything that I did. It was just trying to figure out how to create that type of groove. So that's what I had focused on. And playing upright and playing electric are two different things because a lot of drummers would want you to play on top of the beat. And I was so focused on trying to play just more laid back that it would, you know, sometimes there'd be some weirdness. So I would, you know, ditch the upright more and just stay with my electric.
Crazy how like life comes at you full circle. Like you're listening to Questlove and then now he's your boss.
Yeah.
Right. Another way that life comes at us in a circle is that we have Colleen here, and Colleen was your RA.
I know.
Like, whoa, how does that happen?
The RA to the stars.
Yes.
Yes.
If I ever write a book, one of the chapters is going to be called I Was His RA or I Was Their RA.
She has a lot of stories on a lot of pictures. How was Colleen as your RA? Was she?
Excellent.
Really?
Excellent. Because there were a lot of RAs who were just so extra, unnecessarily. Really? Absolutely. My parents don't live here. There were some RAs who were just real extra. She was not
extra. Yeah, I could see that. Colleen is so chill and like vibey. Yeah. You know, like,
absolutely.
Hey, this is great. This is, can we do this every day?
Giving her some flowers. Yes, you deserve.
So you leave Berkeley.
Boom.
Where's your mind at?
At the time that I left Berkeley in 2003, right before that happened, I auditioned to play with John Scofield's Uber Jam Band. And the idea, it was like right before my last year. And I felt I kind of had this talk with my parents, like, I'm going to leave. If I get this gig, I'm not going to stay. And they weren't too happy about it. But, you know, it's just the life of a musician. I didn't get the gig. So then I stayed. I finished. And now my whole idea was, you know, getting to New York, because that was just the next step that everybody who graduated from Berkeley took. And I stayed in New York stayed in Boston for a while. I played at Wally's. I'd met up with a bunch of different rappers in the city and was making beats and doing all those things, just kind of doing just nothing really after college. And then I got a call to play in John Scofield's Uber Jam Band. And then I went, I did one tour with them. Some of the money from that tour, I paid off whatever debts I had in Boston, and I moved to New York and got an apartment. And then that's what got me there. And then now like the whole thing started over. Everybody moves in New York not to stay in New York, you know. Every musician goes there to try to get a gig that never keeps you there.
At this year's Alumni Brunch in New York, you was the keynote speaker, and you spoke a lot about like the times you had before landing your gig with the Roots, right? And you was talking about how you was resilient and how you persevered through the hard times, even when it came to the last minute when you was just about to go back home to Houston. Can you speak more about that? Because even just hearing you now, and you're like, after graduation, I had to just kind of figure it out. I had to go to New York. So like, what about it helped you just keep going and keep pushing through?
I think just not wanting to fail, because I come from a place where, you know, both of my parents are doctors, you know, and I never saw my parents fail. They had very high expectations of us. And out of all my siblings, I was more of the black sheep. Like I like to hang out in places that they would not want us to hang out in. And all of my friends came from places that they didn't want us to go and hang out. Mm. And, you know, so I was more the one that I think that they would look at and almost feel like, if he's gonna, you know, I don't know what he's doing.
He was worried.
But it was just more like I didn't want to fail at anything. Mm. And I feel like in troubling times, that's a lot of fuel to motivate to fly, you know. But that was, for me, it was just everything was just kind of just always trying to just stay above water, you know, because and especially in New York, you know, musicians, it's a very competitive thing. There's a lot of musicians everywhere, and even trying when I would show up to places to try to sit in, some people would be like, you know, I wouldn't bring a bass with me. I didn't know. They'd be like, you don't have your bass, psh, can't sit in, you can't, you know. And then I'd bring my bass, and then nobody would say anything. And then, you know, there are plenty of times you'd walk around and just wait, and then finally, you know, somebody would call you up or somebody would call you. It just took time. But it was in general, just I just had a lot of stuff to deal with in New York before I finally got on a stage and was able to start playing.
The fear of failure is real, right? Like, so would you consider yourself successful now? And what does success look like to you?
I don't know what success really looks like, to be honest. Mm. Like, I've maintained, and I've gotten to a place now where I'm making, you know, a good living. I'm able to support myself and others. I'm at a point where there are people who count on me. I think success is being successful at accomplishing whatever it is that you want to accomplish. What I want to accomplish is I want to help people. I want to make sure that life is good for, you know, for others. I want to make sure that that people are, like, that my children get a good education, right, that they're taken care of, that my parents are taken care of, even though they don't really need me to take care of them. But, you know, things like that. But, you know, that success for me is not sinking, I guess, you know, and maintaining being above water.
Let me ask that a different way. So if you look at your 18-year-old self, uh-huh, starting down the block here, what would they think about where you are now?
Mind blown. Yeah. You see? Mm. I think when I left here and I knew I hadn't completed my requirements to graduate, I left feeling like, you know what? I mean, if I need to graduate, I'll figure it out. If I need a degree later, I'll come back and I'll finish it.
Sure.
And when I left, I felt like I still, there was a part of me that was like, you know, like defeated. Like I didn't do it. I didn't finish the mission yet. But now looking at it, like I was listening to, I've always been a Roots fan since their first album. And to think, and even when I used to play Wally's, we used to play a Roots song that was a bass feature. I even played it here for bass day or whatever it was when I got to perform.
Nice.
But now to look at that and think that I would be in my current set of circumstances, it's what helps me believe in manifestation of things. Like when you have things in your mind, you're making, consciously and unconsciously, you're making decisions that inch you closer and closer to that thing. I've always felt like, yeah, I'm going to work with D'Angelo one day, and I'm going to work with this person. It was always in the back of my mind. I didn't know under what capacity or how, but I just knew somehow I'm going to cross paths. And all these people that I've thought of, I have now crossed paths with them. I've done songs with them. I've played. I've performed. It's been, you know, yeah, it's been really good.
Can we talk about, and I bring this up all the time, and not to bring up like, oh, hard period in your life, but I think it speaks to so many alumni. Can you talk about before you got the Roots gig, you were back in Houston?
Oh, yeah. I was in a relationship and my girlfriend at the time got pregnant. And so I was trying to figure out what is my move? What am I going to do to support this child? And, you know, when you're a musician on your own, there are no rules. You can eat ramen noodles every day to figure it out. You're fine.
You can punish yourself.
Yeah. You know what I mean? But when you have a kid, a child that you have to look out for, you have to start reassessing some things. And I'd kind of gone through this whole thing of trying to figure out what can I do in New York? What can I do? And I kind of settled with the idea that, all right, I'm going to go back to school. And I have this, my mom's a physician. So I've always felt medicine was something that I was always interested in. So I thought, you know what? I need to make money. I need to do something. I'm going to go back to school and I'm going to redo my education and I'm going to emerge as somebody in the medical world in the next 4, 6, 8 years.
He was going to do a whole career shift.
I was going to do a whole career shift.
Wow.
And so then I called my parents and we were going to go to Austin to look for places to live and things like that. I went to Austin, and while I was en route to Austin from Houston, I got a phone call. I had one regular gig in New York that I had done regularly. And on my way to Austin, I got a phone call from one of the band members who was like, basically they fired me. They said there was another guy who started playing there and he wanted the night that I had as well. So they gave it to him and said, jerk. Well, you know, whatever.
It's
actually, you know what? He's actually a friend of mine. I don't mind it. You know,
it's
right. I feel like that's just the way it is. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, right. So I went, I get to Austin and I check into the hotel room. And like 10 minutes after I check in, I get a phone call asking me if I'd like to join the Roots. Mm. And it was kind of crazy.
It makes the hairs on my arms go up.
You know, like I barely had just even walked into my hotel room. And I was like, and I told my dad, was in the next room with my mom. And I said to him, hey, I just got a call asking me if I wanted to join the Roots. And he was like, well, then we're just going to get breakfast tomorrow. You're going to take your mom somewhere to go at some strip mall to look around. He's like, we're going to go home.
Yeah.
And that was it. And then, like a couple of weeks later, I was on Jimmy Fallon, and I've been out bad ever since.
What an emotional roller coaster. Like, were you sad when you got the call of being fired?
You know what? I wasn't even sad. I was really annoyed. But then I was just like, I tend to not let myself wallow in those types of feelings. Mm. And And I knew, I was like, well, I'm here on this trip planning on leaving New York anyway. So it's like, eh, whatever. Like, it is what it is.
That happened,
and then,
yeah.
It's just like right when I'm leaving, the cheapest car that I'm riding in breaks down and runs out of gas, and then only to like stop in front of a brand new Ferrari. There you go.
That's a great.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
Did you audition for the gig?
Kind of indirectly.
Yeah.
There was Quest was doing. He was curating a show for the Blue Note, and he was going to use Christian McBride as the bassist, but Christian was on tour. And they needed somebody to sub in the rehearsals just to do the songs for him to listen to and whatever. So I got asked to do that. A really great promoter in New York named Jill Newman, who's, she's a promoter to the stars. She does a lot of stuff in New York. She asked me if I would do the rehearsal. I was like, yeah. I was like, I don't want any money. Like, absolutely. So I played. I did these rehearsals. And what the Roots would do is at the time, I didn't know. Their manager at the time, Rich Nichols, who was now deceased, rest in peace, he would listen to everything that they would record. And he listened to all those rehearsals. And he asked when they had, right before that, I did that. It was like a 5-hour rehearsal. I feel like we rehearsed more than one day. We rehearsed a couple of days. And all of it was recorded. It all went to their manager. Quest listened to it. They did their show with Christian. And then he called me to be a part of the B band for their 4th of July festival that they did in Philly. I think I played with Michael McDonald and Sarah Bareilles that year. And then that was in July. And then in August, they called me and asked me if I wanted to join the band.
Wow.
Yeah. So that was kind of like the indirect audition.
How is it like performing with the Roots? Like, it's like a dream come true. It kind of sounds like,
absolutely. The type of music that I really liked and was really into at that time, all that neo soul and Dilla hip hop and stuff, like these are the people who were very instrumental in those styles of music.
Absolutely.
And it was kind of a mysterious thing. Like it was something I couldn't imitate. And everybody would try to do it and fail at it miserably. Like it was just, they just had their own sound. Mm-hmm. And I just really wanted to know how to do that. And then I end up not only being in the room with these people, but being in a band with a lot of the people who created all this music for years, and just to literally be a fly on the wall. Like, I got to be that every day. I got to hear little comments and little things that Dilla would do, where Dilla would make his basses like this. Remember, they would laugh, and they had like all these unreleased things that they did with him that the world has yet to hear. And, you know, that just to hear, like, he'd chop his samples like this. Even I wouldn't say anything, but I'd go home and I'd try it.
Yeah.
This is what it is. You know?
I got it.
Yeah. Like that. So that was it. It's like, it's honestly like, I feel like it was like prayers answered and things that I never even verbalized. Just like things just in my mind, you know, like well beyond my imagination.
Exceedingly and abundantly.
Ephesians 3:20.
So, okay. I have a question. So the gig with the Roots, I mean, obviously, I feel like you're in such a unique position because the Roots tours regularly.
Mm-hmm.
But then also is the house band for Jimmy Fallon.
Yeah.
Compare and contrast those two seemingly very different.
They are very different worlds. Fallon is, you know, I mean, typically we're playing, you know, just a few seconds for bumpers in and out. We do themes for games and things that they do. It's a real uniform gig. It's almost like not necessarily a Broadway gig, but it kind of is. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But our involvement is, it's not as involved as what the writers do and the comedians do. We're just supporting cast, but that's one thing. But then when we're on tour, it's way more active than some of our stuff that we have to do with the show. You know, at the show, it's, you know, I play a bumper, 3 minutes worth of music. If I play with a music guest, I have to be there in the morning to rehearse and do those things. But playing wise, it's very cut and dry. This is what you do. On the road, we have rehearsals for, you know, if we're doing a show with Erykah Badu or whoever, like De La Soul, like whatever, any number of people, Quest puts together a show. And then we, you know, everything he imagines, he puts that down. And then we come in and then rehearse and put all these ideas, like tie all these ideas together. Which in and of itself is before we've even gotten to the rehearsal layer. So we do that. It's like building the show, and the show is built. Now we have to go back and actually play through it and rehearse it. I mean, there are days that we have rehearsals that go for many hours into the morning, you know, and then getting on stage and performing. And then if it's a tour, you know, doing this and having rehearsals every day, sometimes before you perform.
That's a lot.
It's a lot.
Taxing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a lot. It's an intense job. It's, you know, it's good. You're having that experience with all these people and, you know.
Are those little videos with Fallon where with all the kid instruments as fun as they look?
Yeah, it's fun. I remember when we first started doing them years ago, they would come in with these demos like, we want to do the song, and Quest would take each one of those instruments and reap and build those songs. Wow. With like kazoos and melodicas and kick drums and kid like xylophones, all that stuff. And now it's just, you know, we've done it for so long now, it's just kind of down to a science, but it's fun.
Yeah. That was like my only question that I told you, Kyle, I wanted to ask, but it's like it's really interesting to me that like you have like professional bass player gig.
Mm-hmm.
Then what's it like when you have to do like a bit and dress up like a stormtrooper or something?
Yeah, it's fun. It's, you know, that's the added layer of this, is that you get to have fun and do those things where they ask you to act or to say something stupid. It's fun. You know, mm-hmm. it's a little extra thing on top of just playing bass that's a lot of fun.
But you do a good job too. I love watching those clips.
It's like being on SNL, but like a musician.
Do you have like a favorite time from the show, or like memory, or like working with a certain artist?
A favorite time from the show. Like we used to have, I was saying this earlier too, we used to have sit-in guests that would come and play with us for the whole show. Mm-hmm. And these were great moments. It's one thing when you're playing as with the music guests for the show, you're usually just playing one song. You show up in the morning, you do camera blocking, and then, which is the rehearsal for it, and then you play and that's it. When there's a sit-in guest, they come in during a certain time of the day, like maybe 2 o'clock, and you're in a room with them figuring out what songs we're going to play, and it's usually their hits. And in the midst of that, they're telling you stories about, you know, their career and like stuff from the road. And so it's like, it's kind of more of a personal moment with some of the artists that you grew up listening to. Like I was reading Anthony Kiedis' book from the Chili Peppers, and he, coincidentally, when I started reading that book like a week or two after, they're like, Anthony Kiedis is sitting.
Nice.
Wow.
Like,
wow.
So then like I'm like asking him questions about the book and like stuff he went through, and that was a good one. And Steven Tyler, who spoke at my graduation.
Oh, wow.
We got to
full circle.
Hang out with him and listen to all his stories. And Charlie Wilson from the Gap Band, those are always party shows. So those were good. I had fun with those, yeah.
I think it's weird. In some degree, we have this here when we're doing the Alumni Awards.
Mm-hmm.
And we research you guys like to know all the ins and outs. So it's like, Mark Kelley, I know a lot about you. And it's kind of weird. So like when Anthony Kiedis shows up and like you're like, I know on page 58,
yeah,
you talked about that time. You know, yeah, like it's kind of weird.
Yeah.
It's a bizarre world.
It is. But it's, you know, it's also fun. It's like I enjoy being able to, you know, all you hear, like we saw, I think it was like Ray Parker Jr. And we were asking him questions about writing Ghostbusters and some of his songs and like certain lyrics. Like, did you really mean that? You know, like asking him a bunch of things. And you know, you get these honest answers, like absolutely meant that.
That,
you know,
is hilarious.
Or hanging out with Pearl Jam or all these different people. Like you get some interesting stories.
So obviously you've met a lot of your idols.
Uh-huh.
Not, you know, no names or anything. Have you ever met someone it was like just super disappointing?
Yes.
Oh, you almost wish you didn't meet them, right?
Yes. Yeah. There are some people who are definitely like that mm-hmm. you know, that I expected more, but that's the thing. Like they're characters, you know,
right,
they're
very true.
Their record labels build them up to be have a certain persona. Even the songs, like some people, we know them as a certain person, but some of the songs that we know that they sang, they didn't even really write those songs.
Right. Yeah.
You know? So some people, they were created to be a certain character and you expect certain things of them. And then you meet them and you're like, you're not that person.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
You
know? Marketing.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a business, you know, first and foremost.
So, Mark, you have achieved a lot of things so far, and I'm sure you have many more achievements to come. Well, so I wanted to know, what are some future achievements you look forward to?
I've never put out a record. That's the first one of my things that I would like to do is to put out different types of records. And because I'm a fan of a lot of different styles of music. So I would like to put out, right now I have a band that's kind of metal-esque, like a trio. That's something that I would like to do. Some solo things, just my own creations that I would like to put out that I make on my own.
Bass and trombone.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Let's do it. You know what I mean?
I think like, you premiere it here.
Yeah.
Live.
Like, yes. You know, some things like that. I don't know. I mean, I really, for me, the ultimate goal is to be able to, as one of my great friends says, feed yourself with your creations from your mind to your hand.
Have you ever played with Will Calhoun?
Of course.
Yeah, he's another alum. And just yes. Hearing you talk, like, you guys must have really super interesting conversations.
Oh, yeah, man. Will is a great friend. I played in his band years ago. And, you know, being a Living Color fan, when he called me and I started playing, that was, you know, that was incredible. That was one of those things,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Those moments.
Yeah.
In his whole study of ancient African drumming and the drum and bass stuff, you guys must geek out.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Just a couple more questions. What is something that you wish you would have known as a student at Berkeley?
I wish I would have known the importance of slow discipline as opposed to, I felt it was always in my mind that to be great, I had to study in very large chunks. Like I have to memorize this entire solo and once I do that, I got to do a million things. And it always just was such a turnoff to think that in order for me to be great, I have to do so much all the time and every moment. And I learned as I got older that it couldn't be further from the truth. Just walking slower, trying to understand things in smaller, digestible portions did a lot. And, you know, just to kind of believe in myself a little bit more than I did at that time and just to be a little more serious. Just to, you know, also the importance of just my vision of things. There was, you know, musicians are very competitive and there was always this, a lot of people tend to drift towards whoever the popular musicians are of that time. And that's the sound that everybody wants to imitate. And I feel like that's a trap, you know, like those people most likely were not trying to imitate anybody or maybe or whatever, like they just kind of found their way. And then we go towards it because it's something that's very individualistic. You know, we want to sound like somebody that doesn't sound like anything else. And we all possess that, you know? So I think that would be something that I would tell myself to, you know, just kind of listen to myself a little bit.
Yeah, so like the importance of originality and then like your own craft and putting that on the forefront.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Another question I had is, what is something that you learned at Berkeley that you currently apply to your life?
Well, that's interesting. So that's an interesting question. Something that I learned at Berkeley in a classroom or just in general?
Just in general.
What did I learn here? I don't know. I feel like I was so foolish when I was there.
I'm sad this is such a difficult question.
It is a big one. No.
He learned so much. Listen, that's why it's hard.
I learned a lot. I learned a lot at Berkeley. And one thing that I definitely learned was not overlooking any one person that was around me. Mm-hmm. I think that the value that people are we give value to certain people based on the amount of attention they're getting or the amount of people that respect this one person.
Popularity.
Mm-hmm. It's like such a popularity contest, and while that's happening, we're so busy focused on that one person that there are so many other people around us that may not be popular or might not be the thing right now. And they may be even light years ahead of the person that we're all paying attention to, but we have no idea because that person may be silent or they're not putting that on display. So I think one of those things is that you have to always count. Yep. There's so many people that you can learn from that you may not know because you're not focusing in on them or, you know, so don't take any one person for granted. Make sure to pay attention to all of those around you, you know, because that's major. I've seen a lot of people I've run into that, you know, that are a big deal somewhere. And I had no idea, you know, no clue, but that's it. Don't take anybody for granted around you.
I remember when I was in school, one of the teachers was like, yeah, and you don't worry. You don't have to be one of those stars of the program. And I was like, they're stars of the program? And I'm not one of them? You better believe I keep tabs on them now.
He definitely does. Google search real quick. He will do.
Like even in alumni affairs, you know, it's like obviously certain names continue to come up. Absolutely. But there's so many people that we just don't even know right. about.
Yes.
They're doing phenomenal things.
Absolutely. Yes. Like, you know, you just never know. And, you know, just to be, I feel like, did Mono Neon go here?
Nope.
Mono Neon, the bass player.
Let me find out.
I feel like he did. I feel like he went here, and I feel like somebody may have said that they met him, and he was very quiet, and I'm not sure what he was. I feel like he went here for a little bit, and maybe Michelle worked with him or somebody and found out this guy is incredible. Now, this guy, he's a genius. Mm. You listen to his music, he's incredible. The things that he's playing and doing is just, you know, very radical and very, very interesting.
He has the Berkeley logo on his LinkedIn.
There you go.
Hey.
He did.
I mean, you guys want to go down a rabbit hole? Check out Mono Neon. All right. Jaquel is being very gracious and giving me the last question. I don't think we capped this off, but you did finish your degree.
I did.
Do you want to tell us how your mindset about like coming back and finally doing that?
Yeah. It was interesting to, because I did it online to finish, and it was during the time that the writer's strike was happening. And I didn't know that the writer's strike was going to happen. And it just happened that way. And I was supposed to do a tour with the Roots at the time, and I got sick and had to quarantine. And because of them, the tour coming together and all the nervousness, when all the pieces settled while I was quarantining, it was just easier to leave it the way it was. So I didn't even do the tour. So I just got provided with all this time to finish. Mm. And going to school on a computer as opposed to in a live classroom. I'm not going to say it's very different. It's different, but it has its advantages in that I'm not distracted by anybody being around me. I feel like there's a direct connect between me and the teacher. The classes that I was doing was pertaining to music production, and I was doing all this on my workstation in my creative space on a class. So everything I was doing was, I'm doing this from the place that I always work from, which was good. I don't know, like that type of learning for me was great. I enjoyed it. And to be able to go back and watch everything over again, because, you know, class, I tell my kids all the time, you know, when you go to class, you're just getting introduced to the subject. So you may not get whatever they're saying to you, but they just want to make sure that they introduce it to you. So then you got to go on your own and do your work. And so it's kind of to have that ability to go back and look over my class, watch things over again and re-reference things and for that to be built in to the learning is just, it was incredible. It was good. And I learned a lot. And to have that, to be able to make music and for somebody to critique it and send it back, like I wished that this was something that was going on when I was originally here, because I definitely would have fallen into that.
Now, in that interface, I mean, they've been working on that forever. And it was like one of the first ones, you know? And it's really, I've seen a lot of demos. It's really cool. And Jaquel did.
I was going to say, I just graduated in September. I got my professional certificate in music marketing.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So the interface is really cool. You can talk to your classmates. There's different workshops within it. So it's like a textbook, and then there may be like a little quiz and stuff. Yeah. So it definitely makes sure that you understand and are like on top of your thing. So I can understand why it's super helpful than, you know, just being in class as well.
And this isn't a paid announcement either. Right, Berkeley Online didn't pay us to do this.
There's so many alumni who are in this situation where they left right before, you know, they just have a few credits left. And I'm so glad we finally have this ability where they can, from a distance, finish with online.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah. And I think it just kind of just goes into the theme of your life of being resilient and persevering through things. Like, yes, you stopped, but you kept going. You might have had like that vision. And I'm sure your parents was proud saying that they were probably apprehensive of your choices.
Yeah,
but I'm sure they were happy about that choice. So congrats to you as well coming back.
Thank you.
But yeah, so thank you, Mark, for stopping by and talking with us. It was a great show. All right, everybody. That was the interview with everyone featuring Mark Kelley. What'd you think about it, boss?
First of all, every time you ask me how I thought an interview went, I say I thought it was great.
Because they all are winning. But I'm not. No, are great.
I'm not being disingenuous, but I don't know. Let's see if there's like sometime down the road, like season 8, and you ask me that, and I'm just like, oh, that was a terrible interview.
Yeah, like, actually, I think it could have been better.
But no, the thing I liked about Mark's interview was the recurring theme of things coming around full circle. Mm. He just kept going, and then one thing led to another, but it wasn't a clear straight line. It was just kind of circles going around and around. And then it ends, you know, where it starts. He left Berkeley to start his career in music, and then he completed his degree. I mean, how beautiful is that?
Absolutely. I think, you know, Mark Kelley, his story is full of being resilient. And I feel like that's a really important story and gems to give to the community because, you know, sometimes we have plans how we want our life to be, but sometimes it doesn't go that way, you know? And so it's all about the pivot and making sure you just keep going because the best is yet to come. But another thing that I thought was really cool was the fact that Mark Kelley actually went to school with Destiny's Child. Like, what? Oh my God. I know in the interview you would hear my excitement, but like, I just could not believe it. Like, I felt like we was hitting some breaking news or something. Like,
right? Yeah.
Who doesn't love that?
Then he just casually drops that, you know.
Right. Like, it's nothing. I was like, wait, so you were actually in the school? And he's like, yeah. Houston births a lot of great talent. And so it was really cool just to kind of hear who he, you know, recognizes as really important pillars in his music journey.
When we do storytelling, you know, I think one of the guiding lights for me has always been, where's the hope? You know, the thing with Mark that really kind of put that shimmer of hope out there for people is like, you know, he said his car is just like broke down on the side of the road and he stepped out and someone gave him keys to a Ferrari. You know, it was like, you never know where your career is going to take you and how those relationships happen and all that. But I think that's a really good beacon of hope for people that, you know, a career in the arts is not linear. So there's always those times where you're going to have your ups and your downs. And if you can ride the wave, you never know when someone's going to hand you those keys.
So if you're looking for some sign of hope, I hope that you was able to get some from this episode today.
So we have an entire season coming up.
Yes.
We have some new students working for us. And Laura put together a little teaser for season 2, which we can play right now.
These composers have been gone for hundreds of years and their music still lives. I want to be back.
I think the original idea of what the global clinics were supposed to look like and what final shape they took were a little different.
I wish I could say that it was like so linear and I graduated and had a job off the bat. Like, I wish that I could say those things.
So that was the teaser for season 2. As you can hear, we have so many great conversations coming up with multiple people, and we are super excited, you know, to get these out so that you can hear them.
I get asked a lot, and this isn't one of those stories where people ask me a lot, but no, I actually do get asked a lot, like, what are some of your favorite interviews? Who are your favorite alumni that you met? And there is just a whole handful of my favorite conversations and interviews with alumni this season. It's dynamic.
Yeah, and it's like, it's hard to pick a favorite because we talk about different things and you learn from each and every person that you talk to, you know? I always come out the interview saying, oh, this is my favorite interview. This is my favorite interview. Like, it just keeps getting better.
As with every episode, we like to end with a song.
Of course, keeping up with the tradition. Who's closing us out today?
All right, to play us out today is Mickey Rose with the song Beautiful. Mickey has engaged with us on Instagram since before Jaquel came here. So he was one of my go-to alumni that would always share some music on the terribly named Alumni Share Tuesdays because I couldn't think of anything better. So Mickey is extremely talented and has a good vibe. So here we are with Mickey Rose, Beautiful.
Don't deserve you. That is the issue at hand. They cannot comprehend your song. You're beautiful, oh. So beautiful, oh. So damn beautiful. They don't know. They don't know who they are. One day they'll know. tattoo.